Yonapot out there in YouTube land, and welcome to the House of Jonfeld. While attending Botter Fashion College and South Plains College, I was required to take art history, and in those classes I studied all the great masters through the centuries. The artists I liked were never in the curriculum, and if they were mentioned at all in the history books, they were relegated to a footnote. One of those artists was Marcel Vertez, whom I became interested in after seeing his work in the 1952 film version of Moulin Rouge. He was born on August 10, 1895 in Budapest, Hungary, to Joseph and Ernestine Vertez in a home that overlooked the Danube with his three sisters and three brothers. As a child, Vertez was fascinated with aviation and mechanics and inspired by the flights of Louis Blériot. Wanting to be an aviation engineer, his father enrolled him in a technical prep school at 14. When walking home from a long day tinkering with engines, he came across his sister who was dressed up and on her way to a party. He said hello to her and she simply snubbed him because of his dirty clothes. He went home crushed by his sister's snotty behavior. When his sister returned home that evening, she told her brother that he should become an artist, saying he would have a studio and paint pretty girls on bearskin rugs. The idea appealed to Vertez, and he studied with a sculptor who said the boy had no talent. Undaunted, he continued drawing to perfect his craft. One painter taught Vertez to draw in exchange for billiard lessons. He illustrated for a sensationalist magazine and made sketches of corpses, criminals, prostitutes, and socialist propaganda until the police seized the publication. Seeing his son's dedication to his craft, Vertez's father enrolled him at the Academy of Fine Arts in Budapest, where he studied with painter Károly Ferenczi. The outbreak of World War I interrupted his studies, and Vertez served in the Hungarian army as a lieutenant at the Russian front from 1916 to 1918. After the war came to an end, Vertez returned to Budapest and made illustrations for publications criticizing the Habsburg monarchy. When Bela Kuhn came to power in 1919, Vertez left for Vienna, Austria. He entered a competition for a poster for war orphans. The poster came up and wound winning the contest. It featured a beggar woman and her two children that Vertez found on the street and paid to pose for him. Because his style was so different from Viennese artists, he became an in-demand illustrator. In 1920, he moved to Paris and studied at the Julian Academy, and it was there he became interested in the works of Henri Toulouse-Lautrec, which influenced his style. Living in the Latin Quarter, Vertez frequented the Parisian nightlife, taking in all around him. He did many illustrations of people in the cafes and nightclubs. These illustrations were featured in several publications and galleries in the city. It was in Paris that he met and fell in love with Dora Hauser, and they were married July 15, 1926. While working as a commercial artist, he crossed paths with the famous couturier Elsa Schiaparelli and became a part of her entourage of illustrators that included Salvador Dali, Jean Cocteau, and Christian Bérard. Vertez illustrated all the perfume ads for Schiaparelli's shocking perfume and several of her fashions that were featured in all the major fashion magazines. He designed for the Ballet du Sous les Fleurs and the Autant de Mevisuses. When World War II broke out in 1939, Vertez was inducted into the French Army as a corporal, but was relieved of military duty because of an eye disability. Then afterwards, he worked at a munitions factory. Vertez and his wife managed to escape from France 2 days before the Nazis invaded, and they made their way to New York City. He obtained a job at Harper's Bazaar as an illustrator and illustrated much of their magazine covers for several years. One of Vertez's most well-known projects was a series of portrait paintings of famous people when they were little children, such as Winston Churchill, Eleanor Roosevelt, and Greta Garbo. He didn't use any childhood photos as a reference, but instead looked at their present photos and imagined how they would have looked as children. The portraits were a success, and they were all bought by Neiman Marcus President Stanley Marcus. Vertes began his film career in 1924 as a costume designer on Tragedy im Haus Habsburg for Alexander Korda, but sadly this film is lost and no print has survived. 10 years later, he made his second film, The Adventures of King Pozzole, aka The Merry Monarch, as a costume and production designer. Three versions were filmed, one in German, one in French, and the third in English. His third film as art director was Miss Isa, and this is another one that appears to be lost to history. His fourth film was the British production of Gilbert and Sullivan's operetta, The Mikado, designing both sets and costumes but credited with decor. Between 1940 and 1945, Vertes worked on three major Hollywood films, the first one in 1940 being The Thief of Baghdad, co-designing with John Armstrong and Oliver Messel, creating exotic Hollywood versions of Arabian attire. Then Lydia in 1941, starring Merle Oberon, co-designed with Walter Plunkett and with uncredited help by René Hubert. In 1945, Vertes worked on the Rita Hayworth film Tonight and Every Night with Jean-Louis designing Hayworth's gowns and Vertes designing for everyone else. His eighth and final film was the film version of Pierre Lemaitre's fictional biography of French artist Henri Toulouse-Lautrec. Vertes had his work cut out for him and his studies in Lautrec's work would come in handy. Vertes designed costumes and decorated the set with Paul Sheriff as art director, and the two of them meticulously recreated the interiors of the Moulin Rouge. Directed by John Huston and starring José Ferrer as Lautrec, to give the illusion of being 4'6", Ferrer wore knee pads with his legs strapped behind him, causing him pain in the scenes where he walks, and the cane he used was an absolute necessity. Vertes made his on-screen film debut, or at least his right hand did, drawing on the tablecloth as Galou and Aisha dance and fight. Vertes's costume designs were based on the paintings and posters by Lautrec and recreating them for the film. A few items I noticed was the stockings on the dancers had runs in them and the bloomers were slightly tattered, small details that I found clever. The costumes were colorful and textured, yet subdued. They stood out from the standard Hollywood fare, meaning the people and settings didn't look polished and immaculate. The actors looked sweaty and their clothes rumpled. Vertes's set dressings are quite impressive, making Lautrec's apartment look like an artist studio in Montmartre, using antiques and vintage furniture. Vertes' colleague, Elsa Schiaparelli, designed and executed Zsa Zsa Gabor's costumes for her character Jeanne Avril. She did an impressive job recreating several Avril's dresses seen on the poster ads for the Moulin Rouge, the white and orange ensemble, the snake dress and the black dress, and a couple of items like the red gown trimmed with shocking pink and the gown of absinthe. John Huston told cinematographer Oswald Morris to render the color scheme to look as if Toulouse-Lautrec directed it. Morris used smoke filters to diffuse the light, and Huston also requested that the Technicolor process mute the colors and not have the garish tones that were commonly used at the time. Moulin Rouge was released on December 23, 1952 to critical acclaim and good box office, grossing $9 million on a $1 million budget. It received 7 Oscar nominations, 2 for Vertes's sets and costumes, but Oswald Morris's cinematography was shut out. On March 19, 1953, Marcel Vertes won the Oscar for Best Costume Design in a Color Film, presented by Ginger Rogers. However, Vertes was not present at the ceremony. He also won a plaque for his set decoration along with Paul Sheriff for art direction, which was accepted by the film's producer, James Wolfe. Sometime after the film's release, Vertes's costume sketches were exhibited at the Carstairs Gallery and immediately sold out. In 1955, Vertes made his Broadway debut on the musical Seventh Heaven as both scenic and costume designer. He was a little intimidated by the size of the ANTA Playhouse. In Paris, the theaters are small and intimate, but on Broadway they are massive. Seventh Heaven received mixed to negative reviews, but Vertes's colorful designs received much acclaim. In 1956, he designed 800 costumes for the Ringling Brothers Barnum & Bailey Circus. While discussing his designs, he said, "I am a painter. Whatever I do in the theater is a sideline. When I do a play or a movie set, it takes me away from my painting." Vertes also designed dishware, glassware, printed fabrics for scarves, and for fashion, as you can see in this lovely ensemble here. Vertes also published several books that featured his art and his commentary on art and culture. Vertes never held abstract art, or modern art as it was called at the time, in high regard, even saying that the pretty is ugly and the ugly is pretty, and stating abstract art as offering something a little piquant, like an hors d'oeuvre, and that it would have remained so, an unimportant part of the meal, if critics, painters, and buyers had not taken it so seriously. He even published a book called But What Do You Need Me For?, and he leveled some pretty harsh criticism towards the style. At the famous Café Carlyle in New York City, Vertes painted the murals, and it was practically the home to entertainer Bobby Short, who sang and played piano there for many years. Marcel Vertes passed away on October 31, 1961, at age 66. Years later, after his death in his home city, a street bears his name. Here is a watercolor tribute I did to Vertes for my senior practicum. His style was very bright and cheerful, with wispily sensuous females, and he was alternately praised for his adroitness and delicacy of imagination, and criticized for commercializing his talents. Many of his contemporaries sneered at his commercialism and scoffed at his preference for the whimsicality, but they envied his financial success. As you can see in this slideshow of his work, he lives up to his reputation of being whimsical. Thank you for watching, like and subscribe, and that's the way the cow ate the cabbage.
They have a new expression along Old Harlem Way that tells you when a party is 10 times more than gay. To say that things are jumping leaves not a single doubt that everything is in full swing when you hear someone shout. It is, the joint is jumping. It's really jumping. Come in, cats, and check your hats. I mean, this joint is jumping. The piano's thumping. The dancers are bumping. This here spot is more than hot. In fact, the joint is jumping. Check your weapons at the door. Be sure to pay your quarter. Burn your leather on the floor, grab anybody's daughter. The roof is rocking, the neighbor's knocking. We're all bums when the wagon comes, I mean the joint is jumping. Let it be, yeah. Sing this joint, boy, yeah. Oh my, yeah. Don't you hit that chick, that's my broad. Where'd you get that stuff at? Well, I'll knock you to your knees. What? Put this cat out of here. What? Get rid of that pistol. Get rid of that pistol. Yeah. Get rid of it. Yeah. That's what I'm talking about. Oh, man, it's really ready. No, baby, not now. I can't come over there right now. Thank you. yard is jumping. It's really jumping. Every Moses on his toes, I mean the joint is jumping. Uh-huh. No time for talking. This place is walking, yes. Get the jug and cut the rug. I said the joint is jumping.